أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام. كتاب أنزلناه إليك لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى ربهم إلى صراط العزيز الحميد. الله الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وويل للكافرين من عذاب شديد. الذين يستحبون الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة ويصدون عن سبيل الله ويبغونها عوجا أولئك في ضلال بعيد. وما أرسلنا من رسول إلا بلسان قومه ليبين لهم فيضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء وهو العزيز الحكيم. ولقد أرسلنا موسى بآياتنا أن أخرج قومك من الظلمات إلى النور وذكرهم بأيام الله إن في ذلك لآيات لكل صبار شكور. وإذ قال موسى لقومه اذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ أنجاكم من آل فرعون يسومونكم سوء العذاب ويذبحون أبناءكم ويستحيون نساءكم وفي ذلكم بلاء من ربكم عظيم. وإذ تأذن ربكم لئن شكرتم لأزيدنكم ولئن كفرتم إن عذابي لشديد. وقال موسى إن تكفروا أنتم ومن في الأرض جميعا فإن الله لغني حميد. ألم يأتكم نبأ الذين من قبلكم قوم نوح وعاد. وثمود والذين من بعدهم لا يعلمهم إلا الله جاءتهم رسلهم بالبينات فردوا أيديهم في أفواههم وقالوا إنا كفرنا بما أرسلتم به وإنا لفي شك مما تدعوننا إليه مريب. قالت رسلهم أفي الله شك فاطر السماوات والأرض يدعوكم ليغفر لكم من ذنوبكم ويؤخركم إلى أجل مسمى. قالوا إن أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا تريدون أن تصدونا عما كان يعبد آباؤنا فأتونا بسلطان مبين. قالت لهم رسلهم إن نحن إلا بشر مثلكم ولكن الله يمن على من يشاء من عباده وما كان لنا أن نأتيكم بسلطان إلا بإذن الله وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون. وما لنا ألا نتوكل على الله وقد هدانا سبلنا ولنصبرن على ما آذيتمونا وعلى الله فليتوكل المتوكلون. صدق الله العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عباده الذين اصطفى. وبعد, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having gathered us here in one of his own houses, and we thank Allah for this opportunity to share some of the words that we are taught through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, coming down the chain of the ulama who have brought the goodness to us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who can benefit. This afternoon we have gathered here in order to witness the officiation of a nikah, and inshallah, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he always seized the opportunity of a nikah to convey a message. So it's important for us also to seize the same opportunities in order to convey some message. This message is connected to all the categories of people who are seated. There are some who are married. There are some who are not married. There are some who were married and at the moment they are no longer married, either due to death or divorce. So the lesson is for one and all. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابَ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجِ فَإِنَّهُ أَحْسَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ وَأَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَعَلَيْهِ بِالصَّوْمِ فَإِنَّهُ لَهُ وِجَاهٌ. O youth, the message for the youth, whoever is able and capable to fulfill the rites of marriage, they should not waste time in getting married. In another narration, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, three things you don't delay. One is salah, when the time enters, do not delay to fulfill it. If you say, I will read just now, you will end up missing it and committing an act which is wrong. The second thing is janaza. When a person passes away, do not delay to bury them or to enshroud them and fulfill whatever you have to in order to try and get that janaza into the grave as soon as possible. The third thing is the nikah. When both parties are happy, don't waste your time. Today we have long engagements which last long, 1 year, 6 months. That is wrong. In Islam, the engagement is only the confirmation of marriage. The minute two parties are confirmed to get married, they are known as engaged. And the nikah should happen the same day or a few days later. To delay it unnecessarily, that is not our method. It is a method that we have learned from others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. What is the point of holding an engagement so long? It will only result in the two getting in touch in a way that will spoil the relation by them engaging in that which is not appropriate. But nikah has been made so easy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says in the same narration that I first quoted, that if you are unable to get married, then you should fast, because fasting is a way out for you. It will assist you in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, if you get married, it should help you to lower your gaze, and it will help you to fulfill your base desires in the correct way. The problem we are facing today, we get married, but still we do not lower our gaze. You know, there was once, and this is on a lighter note, a brother who was telling us that, you know, getting married is like ordering food in a restaurant. After you get your food and you see your brother's food, you say, oh, I should have ordered that chicken, not this one. May Allah protect us. That is not the Islamic looking or the Islamic approach to look at marriage. Marriage is not like that in Islam. That is a Western idea. The Westerners, they teach us never to be happy. Come rain, you are not happy. Come sunshine, you are not happy. So when are you going to be happy? You need to realize and understand, when you get married, block your eyes, put blinkers, be happy with what you have and continue worshipping Allah. Your life is short, it is not too long. Some people suffer lack of contentment for their whole lives. The reason is, they don't know how to put blinkers on their eyes. They want to look here and there. This issue of lowering the gaze in Islam is so important that it is an instruction for the men as well as for the women. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَوْ قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. The next verse. وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Tell the believing males, if they believe in Allah, they must lower their gaze. Tell the believing females, if they believe in Allah, they must lower their gaze. Because the hadith describes the gaze as a spear from the spears of shaitan. When you are hunting an animal, those who are hunting and who know how to hunt, they know what it is. Even if you are fishing, the minute there is a bite, you see something, you will run behind it and make sure that that animal is hunted. So this is a spear of shaitan. When you see that which is haram, it firstly removes from your heart the appreciation of what you have with your capacity as a Muslim that is halal for you. So you no longer appreciate halal because you did not control your gaze. Secondly, shaitan is now in control. If you allow that gaze to continue, shaitan reduces the value of what is halal, what you have at home. Shaitan reduces that value and makes you think that what you have seen is better, whereas it is not. It is not. The truth is, then we continue wasting money, time, effort, energy, contentment, our integrity, the whole issue of our faithfulness and our trustworthiness is put on the rocks because we are running behind something only because we couldn't control our eyes. So it's important from the very beginning. The hadith says, whoever controls their eyes for the sake of Allah and lowers their gaze, Allah gives them a nur on the face. And on the day of Qiyamah, they will be resurrected with so much light, and Allah will say, choose from the hur and the maidens of Jannah, whomsoever you wish, because in the dunya, you lowered your gaze for my sake. And I guarantee you, those who have that ability, may Allah give it to all of us, to lower their gazes, naturally they will find contentment in their lives. You go home, you look at your wife, you look at your children, you are so happy, so delighted, because you know, mashallah, Allah has chosen this for me. It is important for us to be happy. This is why during the occasion of nikah, we hear some verses being recited. These verses are not a mere coincidence. They are selected in order to be read. Khutbatul Haja is recited normally. Ya ayyuhan nasu. The first verse commences, O people. Because Allah is addressing all people, Muslim and non-Muslim. He is calling them towards something. Towards what? Ittaqu rabbakum. Fear the one who created you. O people, fear the one who created you, who is providing for you, who is in total control of all your existence. Rabbun has a very deep meaning. Fear your Rabb. Be conscious of Him. Make sure you know He made you. Make sure you know you are going to return to Him. Make sure you know that He is in control of your happiness. So if you follow his plan, he will keep you content. Contentment is not to get what you desire, but to get what is required for your contentment. Contentment is not to get what you desire. A person desiring a Porsche, Allah might not give it to them, because Allah knows their contentment does not lie in them receiving the Porsche. Maybe when they get it, they might make such a big accident and break their legs. May Allah protect us. So Allah says, I will grant you what I know is better for you. This is why in nikah, when we are choosing a wife, and even when we are doing other important actions and deeds in our lives, it is important to do what is known as istikhara. Istikhara meaning to ask Allah to guide you. And we say, Allahumma inni astakhiruka bi'ilmik, O Allah, I am seeking your guidance from your knowledge. Wa astaqdiruka biqudratik, and I seek that power of yours that you have that we don't have. فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ تَعْلَمُ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. You know, O Allah, I don't know. You are the knower of the unseen. I want to get married to this woman. I want your advice. I want your, let's word it more correctly, I need your guidance, O Allah. اللَّهُمَّ إِنْ كَانَ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ خَيْرٌ لِي فِي دِينِي وَمَعَاشِي وَعَاقِبَةُ أَمْرِي فَقْدِرُهُ لِي وَيَسِّرُهُ لِي ثُمَّ بَارِكْ لِي فِيهِ. O Allah, if this, what I want to enter into, is good for me, and it is better for me, and it is good for my deen, my religion, and my future, and my akhirah, then make it easy for me, give me barakah in it, and open the doors for me of blessings in this. Guide me in that direction. وَإِنْ كَانَ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ شَرٌّ لِي فِي دِينِي وَمَعَاشِي وَعَاقِبَةُ أَمْرِي فَاصْرِفْهُ عَنِّي وَاصْرِفْنِي عَنْهُ وَاقْدُرْ لِيَ الْخَيْرَ حَيْثُ كَانَ ثُمَّ ارْضِنِي بِهِ. And O Allah, if what I am about to do or what I am intending to do is bad for my deen, my religion, my future, my dunya, my akhirah, then keep me away from it and keep it away from me, and make me happy with whatever you have decreed for me. That is the important part, the last bit. So Allah then puts in your mind that no, it's not good. You notice something bad. You need to be happy with the decision or the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The problem with us, we make a dua, Ya Allah, do whatever is best. That is the dua we make. But we don't mean it in the heart. Because after some time when we don't get what we want, we say, but Allah did not do what is best. How do you know what is best? If you knew what is best, why did you say, oh Allah, do what you know is best? When you yourself know, you rather say, oh Allah, give me the Porsche. Finished. Cut it. Cut the long story short. Oh Allah, I need the Porsche, whether it's good for me or not, I don't mind, give it to me. We are taught as Muslimin, don't make dua like that. You say, oh Allah, give me the Porsche if you know it is better for me. Oh Allah, I am intending this business. Make it easy for me if you know it is good for me. Oh Allah, I intend to marry this woman. Oh, for the females, I intend to marry this man. Make it easy for me if you know it is better for me. If you know it is not good for me, then Ya Allah, show me a way. Show me some signs so that I can block it and stop it from now. Subhanallah. Then when something happens, we should know it is from Allah. If Allah blocks it is from Allah. If Allah allows it to happen, it is from Allah. Because we made a genuine dua, Ya Allah, if it is good for us, let it happen. The difficulty with us is we become selfish in dua. We already think we know what we want. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. So Allah knows the future, and He knows what we don't know. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in that first verse that we read, O people, be conscious of the one who made you. الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. Be conscious of the one who created you from one soul, the soul of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And from him he created his spouse. Now think for a moment, Adam alayhi salam was the only of his species. He was the only of his species at the time when he was created. One human being. The rest, they were angels and they were other creatures of Allah, but he was only one. He used to make dua to Allah, asking Allah, Ya Allah, I am lonely. Take my loneliness away. I am lonely. Take my loneliness away. After making dua for a long time, he was granted a gift in the form of a female. So a female was granted as a gift to a male after the male made so much dua, today do we consider our wives and our daughters and sisters and mothers as gifts to us? The problem is we don't. And the problem goes even further. Sometimes they don't live in such a way that we can call them a gift. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them and guide us all. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us, and He is telling us and reminding us that you have been created from one to start with. Then you had another, and from the two of them, وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. From the two of them, there are a multitude of male and female that have been caused to disperse on the earth and to spread on the earth. Allah says, we created you. That is the source. Then Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, and fear Allah. Look, the first term He used, fear your Rabb, your Creator, because the address is to all mankind. Now Allah is saying, fear Allah. Be conscious of Allah. He is the one who created you. And وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. Be conscious of Allah, whose name you use when you are swearing an oath to one another. If someone says, Wallahi, I am telling you, whose name are you using? Allah's name. You are using Allah's name so that others can believe you. Be careful. Be conscious of that same Allah. If you are not conscious of Him, people won't believe your oath. Some people go about every small thing, Wallahi, Wallahi. How is the weather? Wallahi, it is hot. How is this? Wallahi, this. Don't make that term cheap. Keep it a term that is very high and lofty. Don't just use the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When someone asks you what is 1 plus 1, you say, Wallahi, it is 2. For what you need to use that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Then Allah says, be conscious of Allah and be conscious of Al-Arhama. What is the meaning of Al-Arham? In the Arabic language, Al-Arham refers to the womb. The wombs in the bellies of the women. Be conscious of the wombs. What is being referred to here? It is very interesting. Allah created you, so be conscious of Him. And He chose a certain womb in order to bring you to existence, so be conscious of that womb also. Because Allah is using both terms in one verse, in order to draw your attention that you know there was a womb that you were in for 9 months plus minus. So I created you, but I chose a certain small space through which you were going to come into life. So be conscious of that small space and the holder of that space, who is your mother. Be conscious of your mothers, your sisters, your daughters, your wives, and the females of this ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them also champions of the deen. May Allah make them women who are not material, women who are rather focusing on the life after death, women focusing on the pleasure of Allah and not just on their own pleasure. May Allah make us also men who are focused on the pleasure of Allah and not just men who are focused on our own pleasure. When we choose a spouse based on pleasing Allah, we will choose the correct spouse. When we choose a spouse based on our own pleasure, we will choose the wrong spouse. Look at this. So Allah says, you can fulfill your own pleasure, but through the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah open our doors for us. This is why at the end of the verse, Allah says, be careful, Allah is ever watchful over you, and He is taking account. Raqib means someone who takes account of every detail. They are called Raqib. Because a lot of women are oppressed in private. Sometimes you have person, mashallah, very religious, but the wife only knows their level. Because they go home, they swear, they shout, they scream, they oppress. But in public, mashallah, everyone thinks this man is so pious. May Allah protect us all. May He protect myself firstly, and then all of us. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the best of you are those whose families can vouch for their goodness. If your family can say that this man is a good man, nobody else needs to bear witness. Because they witness your daily movements, morning to evening. It's important for us to know. Let us move to the next verse. الله سبحانه وتعالى says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Oh, you who believe, be conscious of Allah correctly in a manner that He is meant to be. Be conscious of Allah in the highest manner possible and ensure that you do not die except in the condition of submission. Now there are many interpretations to this verse. This verse applies to every aspect of our lives. But today in Nikah, I want to tell you that this means that throughout your life, make sure that whatever you do is in conformance to what Allah has revealed. If what you do is against Allah's command, and if you die in that condition, how will you be able to face your Creator? May Allah protect us. A person committing adultery dies in the wrong condition. A person who lies and who cheats and deceives and drinking and so many bad habits, one who dies in the casino and the club, they are dying in the wrong condition. So be careful throughout your married life. And obviously this verse applies through the whole life. But even your married life, be careful. Do not be found on the other side of the law, because you don't know when death will overtake you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a good death. The third verse, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Oh, you who believe, look at how the instruction is. And I want to stop there for 1 minute. You know, in marriage, we learn a big lesson from the way Allah addresses us. Allah calls me and you, oh, you who believe, look at how much respect He is using for me and you. Do we deserve the respect of Allah? The reality is the way we lead our lives is so embarrassing sometimes that we don't even deserve anything from Allah. Because sometimes our salah is not in order, our tongues are not in order, our dress code is not in order, our business dealings are not in order, our family homes are not in order. And Allah is saying, oh, you who believe, wallahi, look at how powerful Allah is. He is addressing me with so much respect. Oh, you who believe. We are learning a lesson. Our wives, our husbands, our children, our parents, they are far greater to us than we are to ourselves. The truth is, if we compare how Allah has addressed us and how we address our family members, Allah did not need to say, oh, you who believe, but He uses respect. Why don't we use even half of that respect to talk to others, to talk to our family members? Oh, my beloved wife, oh, my children, oh, my beautiful children, oh, my daughters, oh, my sons, oh, my dear father. How many of us can address our fathers and our brothers and wives like that? Look at this lesson we are learning. Allah talks to us with so much respect when we don't deserve it. And these people who live with us, they make our food and our drink and they make our lives comfortable. They deserve our respect, but we don't give them respect. So that is also a point we need to raise here. That I am amazed by one verse of the Quran, very amazed, where Allah addresses the kuffar in one place in the Quran. One, just one. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Allahu Akbar. Oh, you who disbelieve. There's only one place in the Quran. I think it is in Surah Al-Tahrim. Allah says, oh, you who disbelieve. Look at the respect of speech. If we have an enemy, what will we tell him? We will probably address him using swear words. May Allah protect our mouths from vulgar language. And here Allah is addressing those whom He doesn't need at all. Not only He doesn't need, but they have transgressed against Him. And He uses a respectful word. Oh, you who disbelieve. Subhanallah. May Allah grant me a lesson. And all of us as well. To talk to our wives with love. With respect, with dignity. Remember, if you respect yourself, people will respect you. But when you don't respect yourself, what type of respect do you expect? So Allah says, oh, you who believe. be conscious of Allah, and only utter that which is upright. Sadidan, upright, what does it mean? Stay away from lies, from vulgar language, from backbiting, from slander, from deceiving, from cheating. Don't use your tongue for anything bad. Every single day, you must utter words that will result in a smile on the face of your family members, your spouses. Why not? Make them giggle. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Aisha radiallahu anha, she says that at times he used to joke with me to the degree that I used to begin to blush. How many of us have made our wives blush? Let's be honest. The more religious we are, the more we are supposed to follow what is known as sunnah tariqah, the sunnah method of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His sunnah is not only confined to outward dressing. No. It is not only confined to outward dressing. Outward dressing is very, very important. But equally important is the inside. Let us understand this. So we need to go home, address our wives with beautiful names. Call her anything beautiful you want. Let her smile and blush no matter how old you are. Tell her she's looking like a rose. Tell her whatever you want to say, because if you are not going to tell her, what do you expect? Who do you want to tell her that? Some of our women folk, they struggle, they strive, they sacrifice, they have given birth to 5 of our children or more. Not one day did we use words to make them blush until they die without any blushing. May Allah protect us and forgive us. It's important for us to know, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is one messenger, and he is the only one whose life is so full and complete, you will not find any loopholes there. No matter what, you will always find goodness. This is why we say, to study the life of one man will take you more than a whole lifetime. You better begin now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the adoption of the sunnah, at least one by one, and continue. If you are struggling in your life, you only need to read the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will find that he went through more difficulties, but he was much more content, because he was always happy with the decree of Allah. So, these words are repeated when we are officiating nikah. The reason is, a lot of the times, marital discord and marriages cracking and the problems in marriage are connected to the bad use of the tongue or the abuse of the tongue. We are lying, we are cheating, we are deceiving. Be straightforward. Utter words that will create harmony and peace, not words that will create disaster. Naturally, when there are problems, and there will be problems, because man is such that the 5 fingers are not the same. I don't know if I gave you this example in Colombo before, but you see, they say 5 fingers are not the same. Look, each one has a different height. One is long, one is slightly shorter, one is thumb. But if you are prepared to make an effort and to compromise, don't be stubborn. Do not be stubborn. If you are prepared to accept your error, to compromise, to bend a little bit, and to move one each, what will happen? All 5 will come equal. What did I do? I bent a few of them a little bit more, and one of them I kept them straight. Look, the thumb is up, the others are bent a little bit. So 5 fingers are not the same for the one who does not want to make an effort, for the one who is not prepared to make an effort. But if you are prepared to make an effort, you will be able to bring all those 5 fingers on one line. Same applies in our homes. People are not the same. Your wife has been brought up in a totally different upbringing. You have been brought up in a different upbringing. Some of our children are orphans with parents who are alive. What does that mean? Father goes to work at 6 in the morning, comes back at 8 at night. So that child is an orphan. That child is practically an orphan. But the father is technically alive. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. What is the point of that father? He doesn't look after his own children. So it's important for us to bend a little bit, to change our lives a little bit. When something goes wrong in the home, Allah is testing you to see, are you able to solve the crisis or are you causing a bigger disaster? It's important for us to know this. Because many homes today, for small reasons, they want to break. No, now I'm fed up. But it's only 1 month. What's your problem? The reality is we are very stubborn nowadays. The greater the technology and the more we move forward, we are not prepared to bend. Not at all. Wallahi, you are a man. Don't think you can come in the house like a big boss. I don't know if I told you that on a lighter note. One day there was a man, very soft-natured. And people told him, you are getting married, you know, your wife will control you. She will control you completely, you know. So, let us teach you a plan. You are going to get married first night. What you do is we will put a cat under the bed. And that cat, you must take a big stick. And after some time when your wife is there and you are standing, the cat comes out, you must begin to beat that cat. Hit it until it dies. And you must tell your wife, no, sorry, excuse me, please. And you will see your problem is solved. So that young boy, he was very soft-natured. He said, okay, no problem, let me see. So they put the small cat, innocent cat, in the room with a stick. And the wife was waiting there. He went into the room, mashallah, he greeted his wife, soft-natured boy. And he, after a little while, the cat began to protrude. So he said, hey, there is a cat in the room. So she said, yeah, no problem. No, I want to fix it. So he took the stick and began to beat the cat. The wife was, hey, no, stop. No, I will fix it. And he killed the cat. And he picked the tail and threw it out of the window. And he closed. Soft man, but that was the plan. The wife was frightened. Oh, this man, people told me he is soft-natured. What about that soft-nature? It is gone. Look, what will he do to me? So every morning, mashallah, he used to enjoy. I need tea at 7 o'clock. She said, okay, no problem. Then the next day, I need lunch at 2. Otherwise, no. She doesn't want to hear otherwise what. Why? Because she knows. If I hear otherwise what, maybe I will be beaten like that cat was beaten. So he says, I need you to be prepared by 8 o'clock. Otherwise, don't worry, I'll be prepared by 8 o'clock. So it lasted for some time. One day she complained to some of her friends, you know, this man, I'm worried about this cat. They said, no, just challenge him once, only to see what he does. So he got up following morning, he said, I need the tea at 7 o'clock. Otherwise, she said, otherwise what? Otherwise I will make it myself. Otherwise I will make it myself. No problem, I will do it myself. So we don't want to have that type of behavior. We would like a good understanding in the home. You can help also as a man. You know, maybe there were generations before us, and the older people, they considered it taboo to assist in the kitchen. Yes, today maybe it is romantic to help a little bit. You can tell her one day in the year, tell her, you know what, just sit in bed, let me try and prepare something and bring it for you. Look, I'm not encouraging this from a religious aspect, but I'm encouraging it from a social aspect. Because socially, we are witnessing so many different bombardments from different types of cultures. We don't want to change the fact that in Islam, the man is the boss. We know that. But sometimes the boss can also give some of the subjects a little bit of a break and a party. When you work, once a year, the boss says, let's throw a party. Come, mashallah. And subhanallah, they have a good day. How many times have we helped in the kitchen? In fact, I want to change my statement. It is a sunnah to help also in the kitchen. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to milk the goats himself, wallahi. I'm just thinking of that hadith now. And he used to sometimes prepare things himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where are the men who want to follow the sunnah? Where are we? Let us follow the sunnah, inshallah. Tonight, when we go home, inshallah, we will say, look, don't worry, tea today I will make, mashallah. And don't tell me they don't drink tea because we are in Sri Lanka, mashallah. Here there is tea for Africa, you know, alhamdulillah. So, we ask Allah to open our doors. There is a lot that we can say regarding nikah. Life is very, very interesting. It is free of burden. Life is not bird for those who want to make it interesting. It becomes bird for those who want to follow shaitan. When they go home, they have a cat and mouse relationship. Cat and mouse relationship. Why? Because we are not following Allah. We are not following the sunnah. Once your wife gets 1 inch of flab, you say, no, now I'm... You know, now I will go in the other direction. Why? Who is the one who put that inch of flab? May Allah protect us all. May Allah grant us all. It is sacrifice that should earn love. Wallahi, love is something that should be based on sacrifice, not based on looks. That is infatuation. Because if you married because of looks, tomorrow when those looks are not there, you will be fed up. This is something important. You need children who will be looked after by women who are fit to be mothers. That is why in Islam, when you look for a wife, look for someone who is fit to be a mother of your future children, then you will succeed. Otherwise, after you get 2-3 children with an actress, what will she do? May Allah grant us all hidayah and protection. She will say, no, you must bring a maid to look after this children. I'm still involved in Bollywood. May Allah protect us. Allahu Akbar. You have people who will not serve you. They will serve their bodies. For 20 minutes they will be in front of the mirror, fixing their face and fixing their lips and fixing this and that. And children, they will look like a disaster. Unless there is a maid or someone else who is looking after the children. Is that the type of home we want in Islam? No. We want a happy home. Your wife will teach Quran to your children. Your wife will teach some dini stories to your children. Your wife will al-ummu madrasatun. The mother of the home is a whole school. If she knows, the children will know. If she has an interest, the children will have an interest. But whole day she's watching TV, whole day father watching TV, then all the children, they want to wear the cap the other way around, and they want to put big earphones here, and they are jumping when they are watching. Why? That is the trend of today. You are the one watching the television. Then you come, Maulana Ji, there is some jinnat in my child here. Look, whole day he's jumping. But who taught him how to jump? You are the one watching the television whole day. For what? Is life, Allah, all about watching TV and sitting on the internet? Wallahi, these are the crises of the ummah today. People's marriages are breaking because of television, because of internet, because of haram relations, because of all sorts of other activity, and yet we are not living our core life. May Allah protect us. May Allah protect our women folk and our men folk. I think with these few words I come to an end, and inshallah we ask Allah to bless the marriage. We will hand over inshallah to the ulama and to Mufti Sahib, who is seated here inshallah, to officiate this nikah. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad.